Hello, welcome to Global Business. And right here at the outskirts of Abuja, taking a drive in Maraba. And welcome. I am Imewale Ojamokai. And today on Global Business, we're looking at Nigeria's ignored geniuses. Of course, there are many inventions in Nigeria that people don't even know about. Of course, you'll be getting to know them right here on the program. Today's program is expected to be a blast. So sit back, relax, as we look at Nigeria's unknown inventors looking at their ignored inventions. It's the Geniuses program on Global Business today. Okay, so we're here with the inventor of this locally made car. We'll know whether it was assembled or it was actually made in Nigeria. Nonso Osakwe is our inventor here. And first, Nonso.
Yes.
How many people know you in Nigeria? I'm sure you're very popular right now. Okay, so you are one of Nigeria's ignored geniuses, isn't it?
Well, I would say ignored, upcoming.
Upcoming?
Yes.
But so at least some people have given you some attention, isn't it?
Yes.
So we are just coming to give you more attention,
yes,
isn't
definitely.
It?
Yes.
Tell me, Nonso. Yeah. Let's know your background first. Who is Nonso?
Well, I studied electrical electronics engineering.
Okay.
I've been doing renewable energy for a while.
Okay.
But I noticed that we have a problem in Nigeria, which is importation of everything. And at some point, I read the newspaper one day and saw that $6 billion was spent in importing cars in 1 year. $6 billion. And it's something we can do here. It's no longer rocket science. These things are already available. So it's about time we do something. I decided to show the world that in Nigeria, these things can be made.
So, tell me, before we go to the different parts of the car,
yes,
what powers this car?
Imare, you've been sitting on it along for a while you were driving. It's powered by a battery system. This is a full electric vehicle.
Wow.
I have solar panels on my roof that I use to recharge it. And it can run for up to 60 kilometers before the next recharge.
Okay.
So it's a fully electric version. But we are working on building a hybrid version, which will give you unlimited range.
This is your first?
Yes, this is the first.
This is like a prototype?
This is a prototype.
And just by reading the newspaper and seeing how much we import inspired you to do this?
Exactly.
And how much would you say you used to do this prototype?
This prototype actually cost a lot more than I budgeted for.
What was your budget first?
I thought I could do it under $1 million, right? Because I needed it to also be cost effective. But in the end, I spent more than $2 million on it.
Wow.
Yeah. And but if it's been mass produced, cost price of production will be less than $700,000.
Someone would ask, where did it mean? $2 million is a large sum of money, especially
yes.
in this time where they say
Nigeria's
economy is in a recession. So how did you get this money?
Like I said, I'm into my main core business is renewable energy.
Okay.
And this, even though it's coming out now, it took about 2 years. It was a 2 year process. Research on what needed to be done, getting the lead materials I needed to get it done. So it was a period of 2 years before we finally got to this.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, let's go into the car and see exactly what this car is made of. Well, let's start from the outside.
Yes.
Okay. What's this panel?
It's all metal.
Metal?
Yes. Even though we would have preferred to use fiberglass and plastic, but because I wanted to show it's possible, this was done on the street using basic welding materials.
Okay.
Just got to a welder shop and said, let's get this thing done. So basic welding materials was used in making this.
And you have glass too.
Yes.
These designs actually can come in different forms, isn't it?
Yes, definitely. In this is just what I think I could achieve with the limited tools available. Okay. When we do have a factory, we'll have a lot of more sophisticated equipment that can make us get any shape and any size we want.
How fast can this move? I know I was trying to move very slowly, but I'm still getting used to it. Because I hope to take it along with me as I'm going right now. But anyway, how fast does it go?
This one can do 35 kilometers per hour max. It was specifically limited because we want to make sure safety is important. You understand? It's still a prototype, so we're still working on making sure that everything works, and we limited the speed so that we don't get carried away and something goes wrong. But the production models, we're not looking at exceeding 50 kilometers per hour. Because it's an open vehicle, what we're trying to do is build a competition for the keke we have in the country that we always import from India and China. So what I'm trying to do is create a better vehicle that can be used locally, use less fuel, and is easier to maintain here in Nigeria.
Okay, so this basically cannot take more than two or three passengers, is it?
Yes, it's basically what a normal tricycle will do. Okay. That's what we're trying
to do. But you don't call your own a tricycle.
I call it a quad cycle.
Because a quad cycle.
Four wheels.
Four wheels, okay.
Yes. So that's the quad then.
Yes, yeah. Yes. This doesn't use an engine.
No, it's running from an electric motor.
Electric motor. Yes. So how do you charge?
Like I said, I have solar panels on my roof, so okay. I just plug in. There's a charge point there, so I just plug in there.
Okay, so everything is natural.
Yes, there's no fuel used for at any point in this vehicle.
You can get the sun.
The
sun natural
it,
to,
yeah.
to charge it.
Exactly.
Okay, so let's go in. This is the interior of this car.
Yes.
Tell us about the dashboard.
Okay. Of course, we had to put green because we have to show it's Nigeria. It has a steering. You can see the stick for the lights, signal light, headlamp light, and all that. This is the hazard light. And this is the horn. This is the display. If I turn the key here, you can see the display comes on. It gives you the battery voltage, how many kilometers you've gone, and how many kilometers per hour you'll be running. Right? We try to make it as basic and as simple as possible. There's no gearbox, so it's a continuous movement. That's the brake, and that's the accelerator.
So once you press the accelerator,
you're already moving. Yes.
What's that?
Here's the brake fluid. And that's the brake. This controls the brake system. So,
okay. And you said I was sitting on the battery.
Yes, the batteries are in here.
Okay.
This is the port where you charge the battery system. So you just have a plug, you plug in here and plug it to a normal socket in the house. And after about 6 hours, the system is fully charged.
6 hours it
yes.
takes to charge the yeah. system, but with solar?
Yes, that's right.
Still
I'm
with
saying.
Solar?
Yes, still
okay,
solar.
But can
solar.
You use normal electricity to
yes,
plug?
Yes, you can. Just
is it faster there. With normal electricity?
No, it's about the same time.
Okay,
what happens is it's usually in the evening. When you get back, you just plug in, and by morning, you're ready to go again.
Now, tell us about the materials used for
okay.
this.
Yeah, the seats were made in the local shop here. I got someone to just make the seats. The actual body was made, like I said, by the roadside, using metal made in Nigeria. I specifically requested for that. The steering, of course, is not made in Nigeria, and some of the switches, even though they were gotten in the local market, but I know that they are actually imported because nobody manufactures them here. So things that I know cannot be manufactured in Nigeria, I got from outside, and then things that I know that are available in Nigeria, we make sure we use that.
Same thing you got for the ceiling, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
Varieties of highly nutritious rice in Abakaliki, Ofada, Kano. Yet Nigeria wastes billions on rice importation. Cocoa in the southwest, and yet top dollar is spent on imported chocolate and beverages. fruits rot in Benue, Nasarawa, Kogi, yet imported juice line the shops. 82 million hectares of rich arable land, yet no jobs and food insecurity threatens.
Our real wealth is in farming, livestock, hatcheries, fisheries, horticulture, and forestry.
It's time to act different. Time to bring Nigerian farmers to the market. Farmers Market, growing Nigeria's agro-economy. Showing every Tuesday at 5:30 p.m. on AIT.
Okay, so we have been talking with Nonso Osakwe, who is the inventor of this quad cycle. A quad cycle, he says, believes can take over the tricycles that we popularly call Keke Napep, or is it Keke Marwa? This quad cycle, of course, if produced in this country, can be a lot more cheaper than what we import from outside the country. Thank you very much, Nonso, for coming on Global Business. But Nonso is not the only ignored Nigerian genius. There are many more. Our next guest, Michael Friday, will be telling us more. Before then, I'm taking my drive with Nonso. Welcome back. Like I told you earlier on, we're going to be visiting Michael Friday. Michael Friday is no ordinary inventor. In fact, his name has been synonymous with many inventions in the last probably 8 to 10 years. So you may have heard of him. He's ignored. Why is he one of Nigeria's ignored geniuses? We shall tell you that. But he's our guest. You're surprised we're in the office? Well, we will start from this office and then we'll move to the workshop to see some of the other inventions. But Michael is right here with me. Michael, welcome to Global Business.
Thank you.
Michael, let's start. Tell us briefly, for those of you, of those people who are not really used to who Michael Friday is. Who is Michael Friday?
Well, Michael Friday is one of the young Nigerians that has been trying to grow from the scratch to become a name and become a name that will make Nigeria proud at large. Michael Friday is a young man that struggled through primary school in a suburb village, from there to secondary school to higher institution, where you cannot afford anything for yourself. Rather, you try to manage everything from the scratch. But today, it looks as if maybe everything has been rosy from the beginning. But I will tell you that it's not easy growing up, and it's not easy trying to raise a business in this kind of environment. But we are happy that we are moving on, and we are doing some little exploit according to what we can afford and what we can do for ourselves. And today, I'm going to show you little things that we have been helped to achieve in our own little way. Thank you.
And, you see, one thing that is synonymous with Michael, that many people may know about Michael, is the fact that in 2008 or 2009, when you were in school, in the university, Covenant University to be precise, you invented a car, isn't it?
I've traveled around the world. I've been to almost all the continent. I've seen car factories and car manufacturers in many countries of the world. And this particular idea, this particular design, is not existing anywhere yet in the world. Mm. And Nigeria as a country can be a proud country to launch this kind of vehicle on a global scale. But as it is, it's no longer a dream. We have accomplished that by building a prototype, functional prototype, and all we need to do is to roll to the market. And that is the stage we are in now. Yeah. This same idea and production has been patented by the US government, filed, issued, and completed, and everything.
Stop there. Why did you go to the U.S.? You are a Nigerian who made an invention in Nigeria. Or did the U.S. assist you in starting that project?
U.S. never assisted me in starting that project, but I can tell you that the first place I filed the patent was in Nigeria here. And under normal circumstances, after filing the patent, you are supposed to be contacted in 2-3 months that your document has been received and they are working on it and then they are going to take care of it and all of that. But unfortunately, I went back several times to find out what is happening to my patent work and it was not forthcoming. So I move on to see the country that can patent my product and it will be recognized world over.
So you mean there is a failure of the Nigerian bureaucracy in patenting too?
I can say that 100% because I was not favored by their system.
So let's talk about more about your inventions. This is like the prototype of what you did in 2008, or is it 2009?
This was designed in 2009.
Okay.
And this particular device, looking at the situation of revenue generation in Nigeria, and some people will be walking on the road because they are well connected, road safety cannot talk to them, VIO cannot talk to them, some by mere ordinary sticker, they are untouchable, and we see that the government cannot grow without generating revenue from her citizens. So, and I decided, as okay, if this is a problem and a situation that the government cannot tackle, you can go to Beggar Roundabout, you go to AYA Junction, and you see a VI officer trying to jump into a vehicle, pursuing drivers as if they don't know what they are doing. It's highly embarrassing. You don't see such a thing happening in the developed world. And even in the developed world, they don't have sophisticated system like what I put together. Okay. It may surprise you to know that the state of Maryland, they are working hard presently to adopt this technology for their licensing. So I designed this for electronic licensing device that can take care of both the licensing of the vehicle, the insurance, the roadworthiness, the driver's licenses, and even the security of your vehicle. Everything is embedded in this system.
Well, does it have power?
Yes.
Okay.
It has power, but I've not plugged it.
Plugged it. Okay. But tell us, is it a device you fix in the car or what?
It's a device that you plug and play.
You plug and play?
You plug and play. Okay. There is a particular component in the vehicle that we have a universal socket for it. You just remove it, plug this one, and plug it directly to the vehicle, and that is the end of the installation.
Okay, so
the rest.
The issue is you just get the device. If it is adopted in Nigeria, for instance, people just buy this device.
Government is supposed to be responsible for that.
Okay.
Government supposed to get the device from us and enforce the installation on all moving vehicles in Nigeria, including that of the presidency.
Okay.
Because every department or every arms of the government are entitled to their own annual budget and all of that. And the only way they can give back to the government is by paying some of these dues, so that government can have enough money to run.
I think we need to get this to work. So let's see how it works.
Human rights, equality, fairness, the rule of law. Principles that shape a democratic society. Who sets the moral bar? Who controls the wheel of justice? Who protects the weak and the strong? Who defines the legal framework and ensures its just enforcement? Citizens' constitutional rights, liberties and basic freedoms. AIT's legal and human rights program, Project Justice, returns. Project Justice, 5:30, every Wednesday on Africa Independent Television.
Okay, so welcome back. Friday is going to tell us how this thing works. So, Friday, over to you.
Okay, thank you. Like I told you, this is our brainchild coming from this country, Nigeria. And from my own little understanding around the world, there is nothing of this kind existing anywhere in the world. This is an electronic car licensing device.
And as it is, it controls all your information. It has all your information installed, both with the government and on this IC card. And you can use this card as a security device for your vehicle, because you can walk away with this card out of your vehicle. Your key can be on the ignition, but nobody can start that car without this card. It's your personal security also. And it also serves as the card you use to renew your licenses after every year. And the way it functions is this: after renewal, you bring this card and swipe it on your dashboard at a particular chip where the electronic chip is located. It's actually RFID's chip. Immediately you swipe it, it gives you exactly 1 year. And after the expiration, which is 365 days, 10 days to your expiration, the car will start giving you notification. And this is the kind of notification it gives when your license is about to expire or when your license has expired. If your license has expired, you put on your ignition, it will tell you to contact the licensing authority for your renewal. You put on your ignition, it will tell you the same thing. When you want to come down from the car, it will tell you the same thing to remind you and give you appropriate information about your renewal. And if you continue to avoid that, it will reach a certain time, the car will automatically shut down and be demobilized. Yeah. And for you not to be stranded, we have this emergency button which you can press, and the car can give you an additional 24 hours, 48 hours as the case may be, for you to be able to renew your license.
But this button is inside the car, isn't
it? It's inside the car. It's going to be embedded in the car. And when your license has expired, you open your car, this is what it will tell you.
System validity has expired. Please contact Bibic Global Resources or any of the following commercial banks.
So, that is all about this invention.
Remember that this is just one of Friday Michael's inventions. We're going to be seeing more of his inventions because we are moving right now to his workshop to see what Friday Michael, a young Nigerian in Nigeria, has invented for Nigeria. After that. Okay, so this is your workshop.
Yes, sir. Workshop.
Thank you. Welcome. You see, I have rolled my sleeves so that
you're behaving like an engineer.
So that we can do some work here.
You're behaving like one of us.
Right? Yes.
Yes, sir.
So, tell us about this place. I see so many machines. Well, I see a coil here. I see a box here. I don't know. Tell us.
So many things.
So many things.
Well, this is just like one of our practical room. We create some little things we can do here. Mm. We don't have too much tools, but we have little that can assist us in doing one or two things. We use this system to do our
planning first. That is, we have Autodesk Inventor installed in it. We do the design electronically or software-based design first, do the simulations and all of that before we now look for how we can bring it to reality.
Okay.
In the practical aspect of it. Here is one of our beautiful products.
This box?
It's not a box. It's a power generator.
Wow. And this is a generator?
Yeah, it looks like
a
handbag or a jerry can. If I tell
you, it's more like a jerry can.
You will...
It's not very heavy.
It's not heavy. But that is 5 kVA you are carrying with just one hand.
Wow.
Yes.
5 kVA generator.
5 kVA generator you are carrying with one hand.
Hmm.
And like I said, it was fully designed here in Nigeria. And we took the carcass to China to remodel it because there we have access to a lot of design house. Where you can do any mold, you can do any configuration.
Okay, so this is just more like you just do the body, you just redesigned the body, isn't
it? We just redesigned the body, redesigned the entire system. But the initial carcass we took to China is more uglier than this, so to say, because like this is the power, we'll call it alternator or a generator that generates up to 5 kVA. If you give this to many scientists or many engineers, they will tell you it's impossible because of the size. Because the 5 kVA alternator will require two people to lift. And I can show you an example of that here. This is made in Germany.
Okay.
And this is a 5 kVA alternator without the generator.
Mm.
So in place of this big, massive machine, we have this to substitute.
So things are getting smaller.
Getting smaller and getting mobile.
Mm.
So now here, the good thing about this generator, one, where you have a equivalent of 5 kVA at maximum capacity output, burning up to 20 liters of fuel, you have only 2 liters of fuel to run this.
For how long?
For 8 good hours.
2 liters of fuel for 8 hours. Good hours. If we were going to get that to how much it is in Nigeria, that is less than 300 naira for 8 hours.
For 8 hours. And if you want to buy the actual size of this that can give you up to 5 kVA, you are looking for like 20 liters of fuel for that 8 hours. And again, the price is much more higher. The size and the noise is 10 times higher than this. This gives you about 2.30 ohms in terms of sound output. So which means you can run it right in front of your parlor or your bedroom, and you can be in your bedroom sleeping without being disturbed by the noise. So it's really, really effective. It can power.
And it comes in the plastic, because this is plastic.
It's plastic, because it doesn't generate much heat. So this can power one AC, a two-bedroom flat with maybe a refrigerator, other electronic appliances. You have 60-watt bulb or 20-watt bulb, up to 10-20, thereabout, to power just a mini flat for every normal home. And when you connect it with your home, we have a socket port here with a particular changeover system. Once NEPA comes in, automatically
it switches.
It switches to NEPA.
Okay.
And when NEPA goes off,
it starts itself.
The input battery can give you about 2 kVA for minimum of 3 to 4 hours. So you have double output out of it. One output can go to your television and your fan, so that when NEPA goes off, instead of the generator starting and consuming your fuel or noise, like dead in the night that you don't need so much appliances on, the inverter output can power your normal appliances
for about 2 to 3 hours. And when the battery is going down, the generator has the capacity to come on automatically and then switch from battery to the generating system. And as soon as power is restored, you don't need to go out to go and do anything. It will seamlessly change over again to power. And when you are not at home and you want it to remain on only inverter for some appliances, you switch off the main power, switch off the generating side, and it remains on the inverter until you return.
So this is more like both an inverter and a generator.
100% inverter and generator. This is the speaker. It's a single box, and people that understand sound language, is a three-way speaker, low, mid, and high. And not just that, it's a single box that has won an award, even right in China, after development, because it happened to be one of the, or the loudest single box of a speaker ever produced in the world. Hmm. And we have certification to that effect and all of that. And as it is...
And you invented this too.
I designed it, I invented it. Normal speakers will go through coil, go through magneto and all of that to work. But we have changed that technology completely in this system. And that is why a small generator, maybe you need like about only 12 to 13 amps to power this speaker. And it can feed up to 5,000 people because it generates at least minimum of 160 decibel. 160 decibel is louder than a Boeing 777 taking off. Yes. A Boeing 777 taking off, if you power this speaker and the airplane is taking off here, you rather hear the sound from this speaker rather than that of the Boeing 777. So all of those tests have been done before we got the certification. And this one, because of the commonly used, it's a commonly used product in the market, we strive to do one or two projects relating to this. And we have powered some couple of mega churches in Nigeria with them since 2009-10, and they are still working till today with or less of maintenance, and they are still working stronger on the field.
Have you sought for government support in any of this work that you do?
We have done that severally. They talk about...
I know you talk about the patent, try to get patent, yes, but beyond the patent.
Beyond the patent, after we decide, okay, you don't have to wait for patent. Push out what you have to the market and let the people use it. You need empowerment. And you go to a bank, they will tell you that bring a collateral that is worth double of the money you are looking for. If I have that, if I have the collateral that is worth double of the money I'm looking for, I would rather sell that collateral to access the money to go on with my business rather than going to be a slave to a bank. So the system is not supportive in any way. That is just the truth. Mm-hmm. I think it's a high time our government look into how they can. I know there are people that don't have genuine ideas, they don't have the genuine mind, and they want to get some money to make do with it and all of that. But some of us, we don't need all of those things again. It's how to pursue this dream and make it a useful dream on the street. That is all my goal. That is all my dream. So I don't need any government money to feed family or to feed myself, just to pursue these things. If they need to pay for the raw materials and hand it over, and then we produce, they have an agency that sells on our behalf. And then they give us our commission at the end of the day. We will grow from there. And there are many things to be done. But it's quite unfortunate. But I believe and I hope we are going to scale through very soon.
Now, you were talking about this too. Is this something for... Oh, this is a meter.
A water meter.
You did this too, isn't it?
Yes, I designed it.
What's the difference? You call it water meter. It's for your pumping machine, isn't it?
For home use.
For home use. What does it do especially?
What it does is very, very simple. Back then in 2009 or 2008, I have one in my house here in Abuja. Mm. And then there are times we don't have water and it's pumping air and it's reading for us. It's pumping air, you open your tap, okay, just air, okay, pra, 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 and it's reading. Then another day they will come and seize your water that your meter has stopped working, and then they say the battery is dead, you should come and buy battery, you should come and do this and all of that, and all manner of complaints and all of that. I say, no, this thing can be done in a better way. You don't need, I don't need to be paying for what I don't use, and I don't need to be changing battery every year before my water can power, because you can't power this, because since it's installed outdoor, you can't power with solar or the electricity in your house, or the electricity that is not even available. So it has to be battery inbuilt.
Okay.
And not only that, the one we use, if the water board is pumping mud is coming right to your tap. But we did this in a way that is sensor protected, that if it's air that is coming, the system will sense it and block the flow of the air. If it's mud that is coming in, the system will sense the mud and block it up. And it doesn't allow such a thing to pass into your home. And then we did it in a way that the battery can last up to 6 to 10 years. So that is one of the major breakthroughs. And then when the water board officer comes to your home, you don't have to go and read or whatever. You carry your infrared device on your body. As soon as you walk close to the system, this is a transmitting antenna. He will get the information and what you have consumed and all of that.
Quite an invention. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for telling us a lot about all these, your inventions. I mean, Nigeria is so blessed, so endowed with so many young talents and inventors that you don't even know where to start from or how to go about it. But of course, watching all this, I'm sure you agree with me that the government needs to step in, provide the enabling environment, and provide support. Thank you, Michael Friday, for coming on Global Business. But we are not done yet. We have moved from Maraba in the outskirts of Abuja to Gwarimpa in Abuja. Now we are moving to Airport Road, and Deji will be telling us about his special cooking equipment after the break. Okay, so welcome back to Global Business. I told you we're going to Airport Road and we're at the house of Ayodeji Ipinjeolu, and we're going to be talking about the invention of cooking stove. Yes, Ayodeji will be telling us what it's all about. This machine I am standing right behind is a cooking stove. You can see pots. So Ayo is coming around to come tell us what this is all about. Okay, Ayo, you're here now.
Yes, I am.
Thank you very much. Welcome to Global Business.
So, thank you.
I've been admiring this machine. You say this is a cooking stove.
Yes.
What do you tell us about it?
Yes, okay. So, this digital mobile cooking machine, a 21st century cook stove that uses biodegradable items formed into briquettes like charcoal. And of course, number one reason why people don't usually like to use charcoal is that it stains your pot. So, but with this machine, you know, there's no direct contact between this and the briquette.
Okay, so this is actually uses charcoal.
Yes, it uses charcoal and bio briquettes.
What do you mean by bio briquettes?
These are biodegradable items, pure water sachets,
wow,
rice husks. We talk about the remnants of this timber, you know, process. This timber process can be mashed and formed and molded into charcoal-like, you know, balls. And that's
so you mix them together, both that one and charcoal.
And charcoal also.
Okay.
So, but because you know charcoal is a product of trees, we don't want it to encourage deforestation, and that's why this is majorly a eco-friendly stove, and if it has to be, so it has to use
biodegradable briquettes.
Yes.
Okay. So now let's go one by one.
Okay.
I this is where you put the pots. I can see that.
Yes.
Remember, this is just a demonstration. We don't have the charcoals here to get this to work.
Yes.
But of course, we can see it work somehow.
Yes. Of
because
course.
I see it is powered by a battery too.
Yes.
You have to explain everything.
Okay.
First, let's start with this. Why do you have this here?
Okay, because cooking goes on inside here, and what we use here, since there's no direct contact between the pots and the briquette inside, so what we use to cook here is the heat. And so when there's excess heat inside this place, this is what you use to get out the excess heat.
Okay.
So it's just like a chimney or something. So this
like
is
a chimney.
Yes.
Okay.
This is it.
Okay, and of course, these pots, they are not, like you said, this is just, it's like a heater.
It's a hot plate.
Heats the pots.
Yes.
But the charcoal is not kept. Where do you keep the charcoal and the briquettes?
So that's what the things that make this stove so interesting. You have a special place for that.
Wow. Yes. Okay.
So this is where you have your briquettes. I call this the brick harmony. Okay. And of course, there's an ash tray. So the ash that falls out from your briquettes after cooking, there's a container here that holds those ash. But explaining the process of how it works, this is where you load your briquette, and
you mix the charcoal and the briquette here.
Yes, here.
Okay.
So after
do you have a quantity of charcoal and quantity of briquette?
No, there's no specific quantity. You just mix it. Yes. Once this place is filled up, then it's at gauge.
Okay. Now with this one filled up, how long will can it burn?
Okay, the calculation that follows this machine and of course this technology is that this stove is supposed to be able to get you with 50 naira quantity of the biodegradable items, briquettes, you should be able to cook for morning, afternoon and night.
That's for one day?
For one day.
50 naira?
50 naira.
Okay, you have batteries.
Yes.
Why do you need batteries when you have the charcoal and all that? Isn't you just light fire in the charcoal for the heat to come out?
Actually, the reason why we have the battery is that the battery supports the fan and the propeller that
Yes, yeah, we have a propeller fan.
Yes, propeller fan inside here. This is a propeller fan. The propeller fan's job is to blow the briquettes, or the charcoal rather, to combustion. You know, when you light your charcoal,
you still light with fire, isn't
it? With fire.
Okay.
So when it burns and it goes out completely, what you now rely on to, make the cooking fast is, air, breeze blowing the.
Yes. In those days, our mothers those days would get paper and do for the charcoal. So now we have a simpler way of doing it.
Yes.
But with the batteries, I'm sure we can see a demonstration of that. Isn't it?
Okay. Well, so with the battery, fixed, we can use a switch to.
So this is what blows the.
Yes, blows the charcoal to combustion.
I'm wondering, why do you need all these?
I think it will be better. No, you can stay there. Let's look at this. Let's look at it from this point. You have so many wires. This looks like the shower wire.
Okay, well, this is just to protect the wires.
Okay. I can see they're all locally made, isn't it?
Yes, this is made in Nigeria.
Or locally assembled. Probably that's what I should say, because I know you got the parts from different places. This looks like the shower.
Yes.
It's the same thing that we use for shower.
Shower, yes.
And all that.
Yes.
And the wires. Okay. Is there a way that you can make this neater?
Yes, of course. Actually, part of our plan is that when we reach the stage of full commercialization,
okay,
we intend to make even different modifications of this product. Okay, so we're going to have smaller ones, we'll have bigger ones for industrial cooking. And also, one of the major improvements we plan to make on this is to make it come out better and neater.
And I'm sure, is government supporting you? Have you gotten any government support, or have you approached government for support?
Also, on the issue of approach, I've immediately, because I made this invention on the 3rd of December 2015, was when I built this product. And since then, I have been in contact with the government.
Which arm of government specifically?
Actually, you know, the pilot ministry that is in charge of technology is the Ministry of Science and Technology.
Mm.
They have seen this and they are aware. Of course,
Science and Technology, yes.
They have seen it and they are aware. And the Minister of Trade and Investment also, the minister has seen this.
Mm.
And she's also a Minister of State, has seen it and she's aware. But up to now, nothing has come forward.
So what stage, if government was to come now and say, let's do something, how will the stages be for you to go into full commercialization?
Okay, sir, you know, already the commercialization process already has its own stages, like you stated.
Mm.
So the product development, you know, before we now talk about the branding and the packaging, and taking that out to the market so that people can access it. So the technology I already have, right? So, but the way the problem is now is mass producing this product. Of course, with the, you know, cost of materials and everything, you know, transportation, logistics and everything to put this together, the burden will be too much for me to bear. So that's where I, you know, continue to look up to maybe the government to come in so that we can form a kind of partnership for, You know,
one very important thing I've learned in when you do this kind of, is the patenting.
Yes, sir.
Have you tried to apply for a patent for this? Because somebody else can come and say it's his product.
I have applied for a patent. In fact, I have an acknowledgement with from the Ministry of Health.
That's very different from what I've heard today already from one other inventor.
Okay.
But so how long did it take you to get the acknowledgement?
Well, it took me, because I did the application myself.
Okay.
So it took me just 3 months to get the
3 months?
Yes.
They acknowledged in 3 months?
In 3 months, yes.
Okay.
Talking about what inspired me to come up with this, in 2014, WHO released a report that 80% of Nigerian women die annually as a result of cooking over open fire.
Hmm.
Cooking over open fire is just the same as being exposed to about 400 cartons of cigarettes per hour. So you can see, because you just can just imagine the effect that it has have even on the long time economy of Nigeria. So that was why I came out. I said, no, someone has to do something about this, and that's why I came up with this product. And you just can see it, though you cook with it, there's no smoke and there's no danger of anybody losing his life or, you know.
Okay, now if we were to mass produce this,
yes.
And because most likely it's going to be low-income people that will be using this kind of stove.
Yes.
Some people will say they can afford gas, and so they will stick with their gas cooking. But how much do you think a unit of this will cost?
Okay. Going by when I introduced this product, when I built the prototype, you know, prototypes are already, you know, so... you know, the stage of building a prototype is so expensive, you know, compared to how much units cost you have.
Mm.
You want to mass produce product. So, you know,
how much did you build this prototype?
I built this with 35,000
naira. 35,000
naira.
Yes. Okay.
But if I'm going to
do a mass production, which is like, probably going to be remodeled, probably.
Yes, remodeled. Mm-hmm. Because I even have, you know, all of them sketched out, you know, different modules and different, you know, versions of this product.
Okay.
Smaller and the bigger ones. So for this particular one, I already have a plan to produce this, at least starting with 1,500 units of this. The cost price will drop to 7,000 naira.
Okay, so for one of it will be 7,000 naira.
Yes, that's what it's going
to be. And probably it may drop less if they're able to make more quantity. Yes, because 1,500 naira, 1,500 is actually very low compared to what we're talking about. A mass of Nigerians, we're looking at a market of over 170 million people.
Yes,
and so we're looking at probably, if you make, if there's a mass production of this, of maybe like 10 million, then you are looking at a price coming down much more, isn't it?
Yes, of course. And that's actually my target.
Probably 1,000 or 1,500 will probably buy this.
Of course. It's beautiful. That's my aim. More product. The more people that get to use this product, the more happy I get. Because the vision behind this is to just, you know, kind of provide some kind of succor for those people that cannot afford. Remember I said that this technology is actually built specifically for people that uses firewood.
Yeah.
For cooking. So instead of firewood, we can get those people that are actually using firewood now to use this machine. I'm happy.
Let's take a break from this product and talk about you.
Okay.
Deji, what's your background?
Okay, well, I studied business administration from the University of Abuja. When I come, you know, to talk about what I studied, and, you know, it's usually something that is so funny because I read business administration. There's no background in engineering, nothing. You know, it just came to me and I you know, knew that somebody has to do something about this. So many of our women are already dying as a result of cooking over open fire. You know, we cannot continue this way.
So what do you do now?
Actually, I'm a graduate, and after I finish service, I'm a graphic artist also.
you seem to be a man of many parts, a graphic artist, a business administrator, and now a stove inventor.
Yes, sir. If I stress you that the labels you see on these things, I designed them myself.
Okay.
My job. I designed and printed myself. And sir, let's not forget one particular attribute that comes with this stove, is that it can also be used to roast fish. The idea is that when you are not cooking and you have something to roast, maybe you have fish or meat, something to roast, you just open this place like this. So you can open this place and place this net.
Okay.
Here, this way. And
so you do your roasting, barbecue, and fish and all that.
Yes, sir.
So that's good.
Yes, sir.
That's good.
Yes,
and another aspect which I noticed is that it's mobile. But that's why you call it the Deji Rich mobile cooking stove.
Yes, of
Deji Rich mobile cooking stove. It's mobile, so you can take it anywhere.
So that's the idea. Today you are in Asokoro, tomorrow you are in UTC Market, and you know.
So now tell me, we were talking about government support.
Yes, sir.
For this.
Yes, sir.
So tell me, how, now that you have applied for patent, which has been acknowledged, which means that your patent is running, we assume they've given you the patent for this.
Yes.
What is the next stage?
Actually, sir, this aspect is something that has continued to give me a sleepless night, because if you try to look at it, for someone to come up with this, for going to more than 2 years right now, it's more than 2 years now. So, and up till now, I've not gone into full commercialization. It's something that bothers me a lot. But I know that the idea itself is one that a lot of Nigerians, you know, will welcome, and it's one that is an idea. It's something that's a product that Nigerians need. And I know that, of course, people that might want to form a kind of partnership, bring in resources, and let's see how we can invest into the future of this country.
I wish we had some briquettes and charcoal. I would have loved to have a demonstration of cooking here.
Yes, yes.
But the truth about it is that this works. And I've seen it work before, and I know it still works. I just wish the section for inventions in the Science and Technology Ministry would get its acts together and get working to look at many of Nigerians' ignored geniuses. People like Deji, people like Friday Michael, people like Nonso Osakwe, ignored geniuses are in every little corner of Nigeria, bringing out brilliant inventions, bringing out ingenious, beautiful things that will make our lives better and probably bring the needed revenue or needed forex into this country. I'm sure each of these people don't need dollars to manufacture this. This is the real Nigeria. And this is the Nigeria the Science and Technology Ministry, the Trade, Industry, and Investment Ministry need to discover. This is where we wrap it up on Global Business today. Thank you very much, Deji, for showing us your invention and allowing us into your house to talk about it.
Thank you so much.
I am Imewori Oyomokai. We need to discover Nigeria. We need to do business real time. Have a great day.